All right, so I'm going to talk about a project that we started up recently, a bit over a year ago, on a wireless health monitor. And start with the rationale. So the sort of market that we're looking at is early detection and continuous monitoring, primarily in non-clinical contexts. And the idea is that since health costs escalate so quickly as diagnosis and treatment is delayed, ideally we'd be monitoring people perhaps all the time, or certainly anyone that's at substantial risk of certain types of problems. So the monitoring probably wants to be broad spectrum, since we may not know what we're looking for. And it could be a cheap commodity technology that you buy in the pharmacy. And that also, if we put it in the health sector rather than the clinical sector, the approval process is much faster. Although we have a bit of tension between, you know, then trying to use it for diagnosis. But anyway, we're not going to jump into that minefield right now. and anyway, the data would be collected and stored on the device or sent live through a cell phone using Bluetooth. And again, because we're looking at long-term health, we can look at both chronic conditions like COPDs or other breathing disorders or heart disease, but also we can look for general stress markers, which may be predictive of increased risk for disease, and try to provide people feedback that may help them reduce their stress. So we have a prototype. This is a blown-up view of the device. And the actual form factor I'm not showing, but it's intended to fit on a single belt, chest belt, which fits with some of the other monitor devices. Typically, they're special purpose breathing or cardiac monitors. But it seems to be a usable form factor and simple, and there are many signals that we can get from that location. And I guess the design principles were to make something simple and cheap, so everything's on the one board. It's a bit under 2 inches high and about an inch and a half wide. So it'll fit in that strap form factor, you know, with a small footprint. The radio's there. We're leveraging sort of mature technologies like Bluetooth, and that helps us interoperate with a lot of other things. These are the signs that we're currently tracking. I have a video also showing it, streaming this data live to a Microsoft cell phone, which I won't show because of time, but if anyone's interested, I can show you that from my laptop. So we can do EKG, accelerometry, general activity level of the person at, measured from their torso. Muscle activity is an interesting one from the stress perspective. With the chest placement, we can track back muscle activity, which is probably one of the better markers for stress for somebody that's sitting in a desk. And possibly we may also be able to monitor back strain for people that work manually as well. But anyway, that's speculative. And these others are in the queue for adding to the device. Pulse oximeter is actually, the hooks are there, and we're tweaking the amplifiers now. A couple of interesting ones. Pulse transit time is gives you an approximation to blood pressure based on measuring effectively the stiffness of the arteries. And it requires a second sensor that might be in an earring or a finger. But that's a very interesting one, because ambulatory blood pressure could be very useful. And finally, in impedance plethysmography, which I've just learned about, is already in another sensor. What institution are you working at? Where is that work done? In Tampere University of Technology. So this seems to be a good sign anyway, and it's a way to measure lung movement and lung volume. So very quickly, we have another student working on another project, which is a health monitor. And this one actually got steered into mental health monitoring, which is a very interesting topic, and perhaps mental disorders are more naturally amenable to continuous monitoring with IT. And we're working with a public health faculty member at Berkeley who studies bipolar disorders. And bipolar swings and depression swings are characterized by a number of observable features, but one of them is changes in speech, acceleration of the speech during manic episodes, and changes in pitch and volume. And we have some related projects on speech recognition, speech processing on phones, for which we can tap to measure some of these features and perhaps provide some useful early diagnosis. And there are interesting questions of how we actually get this into a sensible observing environment, but it might be possibly environmental microphones in managed care facilities for elders. An interesting one that we're looking at for, since we do also a lot of work in developing regions, would be subsidized phone proxies. Basically, you get to make a free call if you dial through this number. And then using an open PBX architecture, we can track people's, these cues and provide, you know, early diagnosis for people that may be having general mental disorders, or, you know, many people in developing regions, because they're dealing with HIV and other chronic illnesses, actually do very often have mental problems, perhaps in the second year of treatment, when things sort of may start deteriorating a bit. So, well, we're looking for opportunities to try this out in a field setting, and that would include both formal clinical trials, if there was a good fit, a good clinical fit, but also informal field trials where we're just putting the device out and not making any claims or assessment of health impact. And also, you know, suggestions about what other signals or features might be interesting to detect in these small devices. Okay, and that's it for the presentation.
John, not speaking as a healthcare person, my wife's a psychiatrist, so I'm sort of a second rate. With the speech issue, I mean, with manic depression, I mean, you could tell manic behavior by speech, usually, you know, because people start getting really amped, and they also don't sleep as much, right, which you could also pick up. But depression, I'm not sure, would be an easy mark. What do you think? Have you heard anything about it?
There are some papers on changes in speech patterns that mark depression. The interesting thing with those kind of markers is that they're you can't start to, as a clinician, you can't start talking to a patient and conclude they're depressed from speech. You have to see the evolution of their speech patterns over time. But there are certain markers. There's generally falling off. Certain markers are characteristic. They may not always be there, but they're fairly characteristic. And people's sentences start tapering off. There's a lessening of volume, and sometimes pitch tapers off. So there are a few that are useful cues. And so I think there's something there as well. It's certainly not a well enough understood phenomena, because there really aren't the opportunities to do this kind of continuous monitoring very often.